before I start my homily, I'll just mention, you know, today, yesterday morning, I woke up and I realized, you know, I should have bought a kite. I haven't had a kite since I was a child, and I knew that some breezes were coming through New York. You might have heard about it. But then I remembered that when I was in college, my girlfriend told me I should go fly one. You know, somehow I didn't get it. I never did fly a kite since then, but maybe you can tell me what that meant. But anyway, that was a humorous aside at the beginning because of the very serious business of what being a Catholic and a Christian is. To my mind, Catholics have the most right among all people in the world to be happy and joyful and have lots of fun, because we know what Jesus Christ is all about. And Peter, in a backhanded way, helps us to know that. You have more of a right or an ability to enjoy your life more than everybody in the world. Why? Because God is pro-life. The difficulties that we endure on earth are only a foretaste of the grandeur of what we're heading for. But Jesus is telling Peter and his disciples that on the way, it costs. Last Sunday, as you know, Peter was given the name Rock, Petra, a kind of play on words. His name was Simon. Now it's Simon Peter. And on this rock, I will build my church. Not Peter's church. Our church, whose only foundation is Jesus Christ. It's probably one reason why on last week when somebody told me that there was an earthquake, and in the rectory we didn't feel anything. Well, I attributed it to the fact that the church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, and he won't be moved. And in the same way that we can't be moved because we know the truth. Last Sunday, a beatitude was given to Peter when he acclaimed Jesus as Messiah, Messiah, the anointed one of God. Jesus responded by naming Peter as a rock on which the church will be built. Not Peter's, but Christ's. Our Lady of Good Counsel is not a denomination. It is the church that Jesus Christ established with Peter. Well, it wasn't until 1886 that we built this beautiful church, but our foundation was made by Jesus Christ himself. But now, in today's gospel, it's an immediate following of last Sunday's gospel. For the first time, Jesus predicts his passion and tells his disciples that he's heading for Jerusalem. Well, that's going to involve suffering, a crucifixion, and death. Peter hears that for the first time after he's made rock. St. Peter shows then how ironically, how rocky he is in his misinterpretation of what being the Messiah is all about. And people have a great misinterpretation of what the Catholic faith is all about. Peter was large-hearted and passionate. Reasons, probably, why Jesus no doubt chose Peter as leader. Peter wants the best for Jesus, but from a human point of view. And this is the trouble. Peter will have to be schooled in discipleship. A discipleship that recognizes the different point of view that Jesus has, and he was trying to communicate. Peter was so overwhelmed by the talk of suffering and killing that he seems to have not heard the mention of the rising on the third day. Just like we can be hit over the side of our heads when someone we love dies. It is heart-wrenching, especially when it's very sudden and what we think is very early. I covered a mass on Roosevelt Island yesterday evening. The priest who was supposed to go there doesn't have a car, and as you can understand, there's no way onto Roosevelt Island except by driving. Yesterday, I don't know about today, the pastor, my classmate of ordination, had to cancel all the masses today because no priest could get on the island. Which reminds me to ask you and beg you to pray for vocations to the priesthood. There's no mass when you don't have a priest. And the amount of men that are responding to God is probably calling a lot more men who are responding. But the schedule for masses on Sundays is going to change in the future. Three masses on a weekday, that's not going to happen in the future. Unless somebody in your family, a young man from your family, is going to respond to God's call to the priesthood. St. Peter didn't hear the rising on the third day. And sometimes young men don't hear that God is calling them to, like you do in marriage, a man and a woman in marriage give the rest of their lives away to each other. If you don't get married under that understanding, you're not going to last very long. Because that's what love requires, giving your life away. It's probably why my girlfriend was not happy. But anyway, so Peter is flush with his new name. He's a rock. He has new responsibility. And who does he unload his responsibility first on? Jesus. He tells Jesus, well, no, this is not going to happen on my authority. And that's why Jesus calls him Satan. Because he's getting in the way of your life, your future. And his choice is more important than my choice. I found that out. But it's a happy one. That I became a priest is the best thing I ever did. It's all downhill from here, I think. Well, I don't know. But it was not my choice to become a priest. It was God's choice. And all I had to do was say, okay. Well, there's a lot more involved, of course. Jesus rebukes Peter for his temerity. Peter thinks that he's taking the lead. Discipleship means you're following. And Peter has to mind his place, like ourselves, that it is God's choice first. Our government would not have us think that. The implication is that Peter will be the one to take the initiative, put a stop to anything that Jesus has in store for the future. But we would be greatly shortchanged, because it is in giving of life that we receive. A famous statement by St. Francis of Assisi. Peter had to learn holy discernment, a discernment that comes much more deeply. And for us, in our discernment of the future, comes with prayer. I harangued a young man last night on Roosevelt Island about considering the priesthood. But I told him, ask God first. Maybe he doesn't want you to become a priest. He wants you to become a good husband and a father. But you have to ask him. And if he comes, ask you to become a priest, do it. But also say, but I need your help. And if you are called to be a husband and a father, do it. But ask God to help you be a good father and a husband. Holy discernment. In strong language that does not exclude love, Jesus puts Peter in his place, behind him, following him, the right place. He addresses Peter as Satan when the rock puts himself before Jesus. He becomes a stumbling block. Peter is good-hearted, but good-heartedness is not enough. It is prayer that helps us through a false interpretation of Jesus' mission. Think of Satan in the wilderness. He tempts Jesus. Oh, you can make these stones into bread. You don't have to follow what the Father asks you. Oh, you can jump off this temple. You know, he'll take care of you. You can tempt the Father. You don't have to follow what he says. And that's given to you and me every day. That choice of following Christ or the New York Times. Many times they're at real odds. And the reason why we are much like the prophet Jeremiah in our first reading, being derided. You mean you believe that? That Jesus in his body and blood comes on this altar? Are you serious? The same one who says, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. God is pro-life. And when God makes his promise here, he will keep there. That candle, the Paschal candle, is moved to the middle and will be at the head of my casket. What God promised me at my baptism, he's going to keep. what he says he's going to give me on this altar is really extraordinary, but true. Peter, we can understand, has not a clue. But to go that direction, Jesus says, those who follow him will have to share his cross. I read these readings on Thursday, well, before that, but again, in preparation, think about the homily. And it was just before I talked with my friend, Father Peter McQuelly, who I covered on Roosevelt Island. They don't have masses today there, but I got there yesterday. His nephew, just reached 15, was born with spina bifida. He's gone through innumerable surgeries, and another one coming up on Tuesday in Philadelphia. He's only 15. His sister was killed in a car accident at age 18 last year. His parents and he are stalwart Catholics because they know the future and they carry their cross. After that conversation, I went to visit a parishioner who's been at least 2 months in Lenox Hill Hospital. You know, you think in New York, you know, they would have something advanced. Not necessarily. They make, like, big mistakes. Here she's in her 70s and more than 2 months in the hospital. She's carrying a cross more than I am. And then I went to visit Faith, convert, with her husband, who died some years ago. They started the Human Life Foundation. Sometimes I have periodicals in the back, the Human Life Foundation magazine. They're very greatly responsible for saving many lives of children and giving backbone to Catholics who are pro-life and stand against the extermination of people before they're born, like myself. As you know, I mentioned it before, I came to the United States with my sister and my mother and father in December of 1951. And I made my debut at Bellevue Hospital 2 months later. Cardinal O'Connor said, well, that explains it. But I was the same person when I emerged from my mother than the person who arrived here in December. The government at the time would have tried to protect me, but only the church tries to protect me today. It is a discernment of God's will that's so important. To share the cross of Christ sometimes means being derided, like Jeremiah in our first reading. The New York Times will not give you good paper, but our paper is older. We follow God rather than a false idol of our autonomous self, which can be so dear when having affluence and upward mobility. It's probably why many Catholics in public life not mention that they're Catholic. Jesus promises a reward for an unselfish orientation. The church helps all people, whatever their orientation is. I help people who have same-sex attractions. They're confused about their sexuality. The government would want them to continue in their falsehood. I want to help them with the truth and with what true happiness is. But it is a matter of following Jesus and not the world. We cannot turn our back on Jesus because when we look to him, we have more than we ever can imagine. It is a love that is self-giving. Love is always self-giving. That is the Catholic faith. I'm a Catholic, and I'm called to give my life away. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.